Karim, you come from a very interesting experience, obviously with LBC in Beirut and Abu Dhabi TV. So you come from a very, very extensive TV experience. So we're going to hear a little bit of a contrast between your conversation and Fadi's conversation. But I'd love to hear from you. Right now, with Sync Media, you're looking to produce content both on TV and on the digital front. What sort of content are you looking to build? Which one do you think is going to get you? You're going to be a startup. So obviously, you cannot really put a lot of money into production. You really got to test out different type of content. What is the content that you're going to be testing out, and why?
Before I get into that particular question, I think we also, in response to your what's popular online, we've obviously addressed the sort of the professional content, so NBC and broadcasters taking their content online. But right now, if you go online and look at things like YouTube, and some of the guys who have really become stars on YouTube, and they have measures of how many people have viewed their video. This is actually more data than most broadcasters know about their audience. And some of the individual people who have become personalities on YouTube actually have more of an audience within a week than I'd say 80 or 90% of the television shows on free-to-air television. So let's not underestimate the importance of also the media that is coming up in this new world of broadcasters who are all really mini media companies themselves, beginning to produce shows and beginning to address an audience in very specific niches, but having a very, very broad reach. So I'm trying to cheat a little bit because I was in the old world, and so I know that lots of money lives in the old world, but I love the new world and I want to make money from it and I want to be popular in it, so I don't want to go one way or the other. There is a big hurdle in online content. That's just the same as the hurdle on free-to-air television, which is discovery. So you can make great content, but if you're on TV channel number 400 or you're on YouTube video number 20 billion, no one's going to know about it. If you want to maximize the chance of discovery, then you need, if you can, to use TV to help you. So I'm trying to basically use the two together. The other, we'll talk about other hurdles in monetization, but effectively it's not that big. I think there's a fallacy that on online only short-form content works, and that's not true. Long-form content already works. I think NBC's own portal shows it. Abu Dhabi Media, Dubai Media, LBC, Melody, everybody's got their content online and they're getting lots of viewers. So it's not that different on the professional content. On the short-form, again, what are people looking for? Mostly right now, that's most successful stuff is actually stuff that's either satirical or funny, followed by stuff that might go into niches. There are cooking recipes that have 6 million views. You know, so it's actually quite a broad range, and I don't think you can pin it down into one thing. So where am I starting? I'm starting, because I'm cheating, I'm starting in the areas that I know will be appealing to advertisers, so targeting women, very broad categories that would be familiar to anybody.
Interesting. So we spoke about content. We got everybody's perspective on what content is really working out. We'd love to hear about the platforms of choice that you're choosing basically to distribute that content, and accordingly we want to know a little bit more about how you're making money from it. So I'll start with Anghami. You chose basically, from the information that I got from you, you're looking at launching your product on iOS initially, iPhone only. Now, what's the reason behind this, and how do you plan on basically overcoming the challenge of Apple taking 30% from your subscription fee, assuming your model is a subscription model?
Okay. First, yes, it's true. We're starting with iPhone and iPad, as you mentioned, iOS then, and then we're rolling to Android. And if it was up to me personally, I would stop over here. But actually, no, we're having to work on Symbian and BlackBerry and Windows Phone eventually for the region. Why? Because those are being used in the region. Now, to get back to your original question, why iPhone to start with, iOS? We started by iOS because, one, it's user experience. Okay, it's giving us the ability to create the product that we want to do, to give to the users. It's not the product that we would like to give to the user, but we cannot because of some certain Symbian restriction on some certain phones. Okay, so iOS allows us to do whatever we really want to do. It's going to be a great experience for the user, whereby the user can do anything from whatever an application that is beautiful, really, as, for instance, some applications that you download on iOS, you really enjoy them because they're beautiful. For instance, Path. Okay, Path or Instagram started on iOS, and Path is still on iOS. Instagram just managed to go to Android probably because of the Facebook deal. That's a different issue. So what it can provide on iOS, one, starting by the user experience, coherence, speed of use, the user interface do not currently come anyway close on any other interface. On the subscription model, yes, Anghami is a subscription model based, and we will actually be using iOS, Apple Store for some cases, but it's not going to be restricted only to Apple Store. 30% might be a lot, but relatively speaking, it's one of the things that we like in iPhone that I haven't mentioned yet, which is that everybody on iPhone is actually have its credit card details available. So it's a one-click experience to subscribe. The one-click experience is something that is really underrated. You would probably on Amazon, I'm not sure who uses Amazon over here in the audience, but from those who like Amazon, who actually use the one-click on the Amazon website most often than going through the entire procedure? Can I see a show of hands? Nobody uses Amazon. Okay, so I do believe that those who uses Amazon actually do the one-click experience. It's very simple. You would actually, if without the one-click experience, it would probably take you a while. You want to get your wallet, put in your credit card, and try to type it, then think about whether I want to pay that this month or not, then probably stop it. One-click experience is extremely important for us. Over the long run, we might shift out from my phone to different payment gateways, and we're actually on several payment gateways. But iPhone for us constitutes the ability to be really directly go to the user, and 30% is acceptable for that price.
Okay, let me look at this scenario for you. And so hopefully within a couple of years you have millions of users, okay? And you go to the labels. Obviously your sources of content are limited. The labels are a handful at the end of the day, and you have a high usage, and they come and basically challenge your model. They want more money from you, because that's what's happening nowadays with Spotify. It's happening with all of the different streaming providers. So what are you going to do in this case? You have 30% going to Apple. You have labels really giving you a hard time with the cost of content. So your margins are going to be shrinking. What would you do then?
Okay. One, as I probably didn't clarify clearly, we are not using only Apple iStore, okay? So we will use it in the initial phase because it's easier to get a take up out of this. But on the long run, we do not intend to remain linked to Apple only. This strategy has been used by a lot of people. Eventually, we believe that apps will convert to becoming HTML apps, and that and actually this is something that we are already working on. And when we are on that phase, we will actually be in control of the user payment much simpler. Okay, actually we are working on with payment gateways to integrate a one-click payment approach outside of the iPhone app, and this is why we will have a functionality whereby user will actually get by email a link to actually register and put his iPhone credit card details. If he puts it over web, then we skip the entire iPhone functionality, iPhone Apple Store, and we'll be able to be in control of the subscription process. Quote unquote, the subscription process doesn't happen through traditional payment gateways available in the region because, not because of the 40,000 dirhams that was mentioned, or the 6%, or the monthly fees, which are, by the way, exorbitant, but because the payment gateways in the region do not allow us to have an API functionality, meaning be able to call a request to charge the user upon the renewal of a subscription. This is intrinsic to creating a good working long-term subscription-based service. And this is why we're going through that road. Apple gives us that, then we're going to use it in that case. Android market, Google Play Store gives us that, then we're going to go through that place. But eventually, over the long run, we intend to be fully in control of the user's experience and the user's details by having all of that on our store. This is down the road. This is not day one.
Great. Yeah. You're pretty fixated on.
You are not happy with the 70%. I will not come back to the years where we used to pay operators 70% and to get 30%. So 70% is Alhamdulillah. So now it's, you know, we should, you know, should think of thank exactly Apple for the 70%, for the generosity of Apple, and think how we can, you know, think of distribution. If I will answer you about my platform of choice, I will tell you my distribution of choice. We all run to Apple, not because it's the best solution, or iOS the best platform, because they offer the best alternative for the misery where we were living with operators or with TV channels. So that's the way we all ran towards Apple. And that's the way today we are happy with 70%, even though I would be happy to give them 50%, because the ease of distribution and the ease of payment. And that's where we have to think about the choice of platform. It's not the technology. Technology is the easiest part today to work on. The difficult part, as always, is distribution and how to get your money. It's not monetization or having a credit card. It's just a matter of getting your check paid by end of the month. And that was never been offered by operators at that time or before Apple, because it just changed, or by good partners like TVs.
Let's just add, sorry, that even operators right now, because of the threat that Apple changing right now, anybody can create an app and sell it on the store. It doesn't have to go through the premium SMS that used to be the king and crown in the region. But even operators now are waking up, and the 70 or 60% are getting reduced to 30% or something similar to Apple's offering, because hey, they realize that just a dumb pipe, and they are able to provide the payment. Let them provide the service, otherwise no one is going to use those services anymore.